A very good morning to all my colleagues, dear participants, and our eminent speakers. I, Mridul Ghosh, Assistant Professor and Head of the Department of Computer Science, Shampu Siddheshwari Mahavidyalaya, would like to welcome you all in our one-day national webinar entitled National Education Policy 2020, Challenges and Opportunities, which is jointly organized by the Departments of Education and Computer Science, Shampu Siddheshwari Mahavidyalaya, Department of Education, Ramsadaya College, Amta, and Gaurav Gui Memorial College, Poshchim Medinipur, in association with IQAC of the respective colleges. National Education Policy is a comprehensive framework to guide the development of education in our country. The discussion on this topic is very much necessary since new education policy or NEP has been approved by the cabinet and has been released in this year. The much awaited policy has brought several changes to the education system from school level to the college level. A committee led by former Indian Space Research Organization ISRO chief, Dr. K. Kostirirangan, formed the draft of NEP on the foundational pillars of access, equity, quality, affordability, and accountability. The new NEP replaces the one formulated in 1986, which is 34 years ago. The new education policy 2020 will be available in 22 languages and audiobooks. To discuss on this topic, today we have had eminent speakers, Professor Ashish Srivastava, Dean, School of Education, Mahatma Gandhi Central University, East Champaran, Bihar, and Professor Dr. Namakumar Mandol, Professor, Department of Environmental Science, University of Burdwan, West Bengal. We will start our program by the welcome speech of Dr. S.K. Bose, Principal, Shampu Siddheshwari Mahavidyalaya, Dr. Dev Kumar Mukherjee, Principal, Ramsadaya College, and Dr. Tapon Hajra, Teacher in Charge of Gaurav Gui Memorial College.
Good morning, everybody. First of all, I welcome all the participants in the national level webinar on National Education Policy 2020, Challenges and Opportunities, being organized jointly by the Department of Education of Ramsadaya College, Gaurav Gui Memorial College, and our college, Shampu Siddheshwari Mahavidyalaya, along with the Department of Computer Science, in association with the internal quality assurance cell of these colleges. I would like to convey thanks to the honorable speakers of this webinar, Professor Ashish Srivastava, Dean, School of Education, Mahatma Gandhi Central University, East Champaran, Bihar, and Dr. Namakumar Mandol, Professor, Department of Environmental Science, the University of Burdwan, who will deliver their valuable lectures in this webinar. I would also like to convey thanks to Dr. Dev Kumar Mukherjee, Principal, Ramsadaya College, Dr. Tapon Hajra, Teacher in Charge, GG Memorial College, the coordinators and members of the Internal Quality Assurance Cell, and the teachers of the Department of Education of these colleges, who deserve it for arranging such a webinar in this time of pandemic. I think the participants will be benefited from this webinar. I expect a grand success of this webinar. Thank you all once again.
Thank you very much, sir. Now I welcome Dr. Dev Kumar Mukherjee, Principal, Ramsadaya College, Amta.
Good morning, everybody. I take this opportunity to express my sincere gratitude, my admiring regards to all those who are present live on this webinar program, and particularly to the members of the organizing committee of three educational institutions who have been instrumental in conducting this national webinar for the benefit of the student and the teaching community. The big question that arises in my mind is why the need has come to implement the national policy. Is the educational system what we are following right now is faulty, outdated, or we want to increase our global ranking among the institutions worldwide, or we want to privatize the education system as a whole to attract foreign investment? Whatever may be the reason, to be more optimistic, I personally feel that this National Education Policy 2020 aims at the development of creating individual potential and lays more emphasis on the rich heritage of ancient and eternal Indian knowledge and thought. The focus of the policy is to create, develop good human beings capable of individual thought and action, scientific temper, and creative imagination at all stages of education. The government of India is well aware that an empty stomach can never digest any word apart from food. And so, in addition to the midday meal program, what we are having right now, this new policy has introduced the concept of providing healthy breakfast to all school-going children in order to develop an holistic mode of education in them, in academic as well as non-academic activities. We have with us two distinguished speakers who will be dealing with the education policy in details, and we will be informed about the pros and cons of these policies. But what I personally feel is that we have the niti now. What is more important is the rananiti, the action plan. And we are more eager to see what our central government as well as the state governments are doing to implement this policy in a more fruitful and in a more purposeful way. So thank you all for being with us, and wishing you all the best for a wonderful morning session interacting with the speakers. So thank you, and over to the program coordinators for the next course of action.
Thank you very much, sir, for your nice words. Now I would like to request Dr. Tapan Hajra, TIC of Gaurav Goyi Memorial College, to say a few words for this webinar. May I request Dr. Tapan Hajra? I think there is some network issue. Sir is unable to connect. Okay, now we move on. I request IQAC member of Shampu Siddheshwari Mahavidyalaya, Srimati Choitali Chakraborty, to say few words about this webinar.
Hey everybody. On behalf of Internal Quality Assurance Cell, Shampu Siddheshwari Mahavidyalaya, I welcome you all to the national webinar on National Education Policy 2020, Challenges and Opportunities, organized by the Departments of Computer Science and the Department of Education, Shampu Siddheshwari Mahavidyalaya, Department of Education, Ramshodoy College, Howrah, and Department of Education, Gaurav Goyi Memorial College, Poshchim Mednipur, in association with Internal Quality Assurance Cell of the respective colleges. First of all, I would like to express my sincere thanks to our Principal Sir, Dr. S.K. Bose, without whose constant support and inspiration, these programs and such other programs would not have been possible. I would also like to thank Sri Kalipodo Mondol, President, Governing Body, and Sri Nodebashi Jana, Member, Governing Body of our college, who have inspired us continuously in this trying time. My sincere thanks also goes to Dr. Dev Kumar Mukherjee, Principal, Ramshodoy College, and Dr. Topon Hajra, Teacher in Charge, Gaurav Gui Memorial College. I also thank and welcome Professor Ashish Srivastava from Mahatma Gandhi Central University, Bihar, and Professor Dr. Nobokumar Mondol from University of Burdwan for accepting our invitation and taking our time from their extremely busy schedule. I would also like to appreciate the efforts of Dr. Srikanto Nondi, Department of Education, and Professor Mridul Ghosh, Department of Computer Science, for organizing the webinar on such a pertinent topic. My sincere thanks goes to the organizing secretaries of this webinar, Dr. Pankaj Kumar Pal, Gaurav Gui Memorial College, and Sri Shubhajit Ghosh, Ramshodoy College. And finally, thank you, Professor Rajurshi Mukherjee, Coordinator ECAC, for inviting me to speak on such an occasion. And my thanks to the entire technical team of Internal Quality Assurance Cell. Now we are going to we are going through a critical time these days. COVID-19 pandemic has affected educational systems worldwide, leading to the closure of educational institutions for a long time. It is estimated that this pandemic has created the largest disruption in history, affecting nearly 1.6 billion learners in more than 190 countries and across all continents. We have witnessed unprecedented migration of people in enormous distress, loss of employment on a scale that has not been witnessed in decades, and an overall dislocation, the impact of which we are yet to understand. The National Education Policy has been approved by the Union Cabinet in July 2020, replacing the National Education Policy of 1986. Now, as we know, the aim of any policy concerning education shall aim at transforming and creating a dynamic system of education that will open our minds to excellence, with emphasis on holistic, equitable, and inclusive education. Whether the new education policy could implement such ideals in reality at this critical juncture and provide a comprehensive framework to guide the development of education in the country remains to be seen. Now, with these few words, I hand over the microphone to the coordinator of this program. Thank you.
Thank you, Didi. I now request Mr. Shubhajit Kumar Ghosh to introduce our first speaker, Professor Ashish Srivastava.
Good morning, everyone. Myself, Shubhajit Kumar Ghosh, Head, Department of Education, Ramshodoy College. Dear participants, as we all aware that National Education Policy 2020, which was approved by the Union Cabinet of India on 29th July, outlining the vision of new education system across the country. The policy having comprehensive framework from elementary education to higher education, as well as vocational education, professional education, aims to transform Indian education by 2040. The new education policy has brought excessive changes in various aspects, aim, structures, curriculum, evaluation, administration, etc. And emphasis has been given on gross enrollment ratio, formation of higher education institution clusters and knowledge hubs, and establishment of multidisciplinary universities by removing of fragmentation and harmful silos. For the detailed discussion today, we have with us two eminent speakers. Before introducing our first speaker of the morning, I have an announcement for the participants. Dear participants who are willing to ask questions to the resource person, may write down your questions in the chat box. We will ask it to the resource person in the question answer session. Thank you. Now I am very much happy and excited to introduce our first resource person of the program. Most vibrant, enthusiastic and dynamic personality in the field of education, whom I admire most. My teacher, Guruji, Professor Ashish Srivastava, Dean, School of Education, Mahatma Gandhi Central University, East Champaran, Bihar. Professor Ashish Srivastava sir has vast knowledge and versatile experience in teaching in various renowned institutions across India. Before joining as founder, head and dean in School of Education, Mahatma Gandhi Central University, East Champaran, Bihar, he has served to Vishwa Bharati Shanti Niketan, the ashrama of Nobel laureate Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore, and almost a decade. And his undeniable contribution was led department to the pinnacle of success and set a standard across the nation. Sir has also served under University of Lucknow, Amity University, Uttar Pradesh, before getting appointment in two prestigious universities of India, that is Benaras Hindu University and Vishwa Bharati Shanti Niketan, a central university and an institution of national importance in 2010. Professor Ashish Srivastava is an alumnus of University of Lucknow, Uttar Pradesh and Devi Ahalya Vishwavidyalaya, Indore, Madhya Pradesh. Sir has rich experience of traveling and delivering lecture to different prestigious universities and institutions of education of different strata across India. His area of interest is educational policies and programs and has plenty of publications in his credit to address this issue. Welcome, sir. Welcome you in the virtual platform of the one-day national webinar entitled National Education Policy 2020, Challenges and Opportunities. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Let me know, can you hear me and am I visible?
Yes, sir. You are audible and perfectly visible.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Oh, fine. Thank you. Thank you so much, Shubhajit Ghosh. At the outset, let me express my heartfelt thanks to all the three colleges, the Department of Computer Science and Department of Education of Shyampur Siddheshwari Mahavidyalaya, Department of Education Ramasadai College, and Department of Education Gaurav Gwin Memorial College. And at the outset only, let me congratulate all the three principals, Dr. S.K. Bose, Dr. Deb Kumar Mukherjee, Dr. Tapan Hajra, and the coordinator, IQAC coordinator, Rajarshi Mukherjee ji, conveners of this program, Shrikant Nandi, Mridul Ghosh, Pankaj Kumar Paul, and Mr. Shubhajit Kumar Bose. All the members of webinar committee. So, I special mention to my very good and one of my best students in my career, Mr. Shubhajit Kumar Ghosh, who have been my wonderful student in Shanti Niketan, and is continuing this wonderful relation with me so far. We all are affected by this euphoria, what I am saying for last 5 weeks. We all are affected by the euphoria of National Education Policy 2020. It is now almost for 5 weeks now. So I will be taking a clue from wonderful line by the principal of Ramasadai College, Dr. Dev Kumar Mukherjee ji, who said in his opening remark that Raniti is now required. Raniti is now required. I liked this line like anything, because what I am saying for last more than 5 weeks, that policy is there, policy is a reality. Whether we praise it, whether we criticize it, whether we like it, whether we dislike it, this policy is a reality now. So what Principal Dr. Deb Kumar Mukherjee has said in his opening remark, that now this is the right time when we need to focus on Ranniti. Only, it is only Ranniti. It is only implementation strategy. It is only a program of effective program of action which will take this policy to its success. Otherwise, we all know that we have seen many failure of earlier policies in last more than 7.5 decades. So as we all are aware that we have this new policy which is ambitious, which is progressive, which is forward looking, and which is aiming to make the education system holistic, flexible, multidisciplinary, and this policy is aligned to the needs of 21st century and 2030 sustainable development goals. So instead of and we all know that this whole policy is divided into four parts. The part one is dealing with the school education, part two is dealing with higher education, part three dealing with other key areas, and part four is dealing with making it happen. So it's a comprehensive policy of 62 pages. So what I personally believe is I am not going to read policy at all, and I don't have enough time to cover all the segments. So keeping in view the involvement of higher education institutions here in this for this particular webinar, I will be focusing myself on higher education only. So again, I congratulate all the institutions. Again, I congratulate Subhajit Kumar Ghosh and the whole team to conceive this webinar, through which we can work, we can understand, we can reflect over Ranniti. I like this term quoted by Dr. Deb Kumar Mukherjee ji, Ranniti. So when we will be in a position to formulate our Ranniti, which is implementation strategy, which is effective program of action, which is effective overall strategy to achieve the intent of this National Education Policy 2020. So we all are aware that as an independent nation, we got our first National Education Policy along with its program of action after 45 years of independence. When I'm saying after 45 years of independence, I am not at all mentioning here the policy of 68 and the policy of 86, because we all know the reasons. So since it in independence till date, we have certain concerns, we have certain worries, which is related with the status, which is related with the quality, which is related with the reach. So far as our achievement at global level is concerned in last more than 7.5 decades. So this policy, particularly in this given time, I will be focusing myself on higher education sector. See, when we will be dealing with higher education sector, this policy highlights this whole periphery of higher education into certain heads, and those heads are institutional restructuring and consolidation towards a more holistic and multidisciplinary education, like what Subhajit Ghosh said in his opening remark, that this policy is breaking different silos and converting the whole higher education system into a multidisciplinary one. Then it the whole higher education and this policy is being covered under optimal learning environments and support for a student. Then it is dealing with internationalization. Then it is dealing with motivated, energized, and capable faculty. Then it is dealing with equity and inclusion in higher education. Then it is dealing with teacher education. Then it is dealing with reimagining vocational education. Then it is dealing with National Research Foundation. Then it is dealing with transforming the regulatory system of higher education, then curbing commercialization of education, and then it is covering effective governance and leadership for higher education institutions. So these are few major heads under which this policy is covering the whole arena of higher education. When we look at these headings under which this national education policy is covering the sector of higher education, and since we are a human being, we are dealing living in a social milieu. So from our own experiences, we understand that there are certain challenges which we need to understand, which we need to keep in our mind while formulating the Ranniti, formulating the implementation strategies, formulating the program of action. So these challenges are coping with the technology and digital divide, reaching unreached with quality education. This is again a very important challenge in front of us, reaching unreached with quality education. We all are aware that in India, we are divided. India is already divided country into plenty of parameters, plenty of indicators on the caste, on region, on religion, on language, on gender, etc. But it is divided into the quality of institutions. For example, if you see the quality of institutions in located in Delhi will be differing from the quality of institutions located in Purulia. So reaching and reach with quality education is another challenge. Another challenge which we need to keep in our mind is ensuring equity. Ensuring equity. Why I'm emphasizing on ensuring equity is because this policy is inviting different private players. The policy is going to take different private players on board. So when we will be having private players on board, we need to formulate certain strategies through which we can ensure equity. Then another challenge is ensuring the minimum essential prerequisite resources to the public institutions, because we all are aware from our practical experiences that plenty of public institutions are fighting, somehow surviving, and there are crunch of resources. Then another challenge which we need to keep in mind is autonomy. See, I personally believe in autonomy, but what I personally believe is autonomy with accountability only. Then we have another challenge to stop brain drain. However, this brain drain has reduced drastically, but still we need to work more and more on it. Then another challenge which we all aware that standard of research, we all are aware on standards of research, irrespective of discipline. You talk about social science research in humanities, researches of sciences, all areas, in any areas, standard of research is another challenge. Then another challenge is raising aspirations and reducing external interventions. So what I personally say is we have committed many mistakes. We have committed plenty of blunders since independence till today. And as a result, there is a lack of confidence, lack of self-confidence, lack of desired aspirations. So we need to work on raising aspirations. Also, we need to work on reducing external interventions. Then, since we all are living in society, we all are having certain experiences. We understand that we are surrounded with plenty of peoples who lack, who need to work on their integrity, their accountability, their responsibility, their morality, their professionalism, etc. And the last challenge is See, this policy is discussing, this policy is saying that they will be taking GER, gross enrollment ratio, to 50% by 2035, which is 26.3% as of 2018. So on the one hand, we need to work on quantification, and on the other hand, we need to work on quality education, because our past experiences are not good. We all understand that we worked on quantification, but we lagged on so far as the quality output, the quality results, and the quality achievers are concerned. So this time we need to work on quantification simultaneously with quality education. What I am personally saying for last many weeks, that this, when policy is revisiting whole higher education sector, the policy is relying on world-class institutions of ancient India only. So the policy is taking reference, the policy is taking, policy is influenced, the policy is working, the policy is recommending keeping those institutions of ancient India only. For example, you can say Takshila, Nalanda, Vikramshila, Vallabhi. And the policy believes that those institutions, in their time, they set highest standards of multidisciplinary teaching and research. And those institutions hosted scholars and students across the globe. And therefore, when they are quoting these institutions, they are focusing, they are having the great scholars produced by those institutions, like policy saying Charak, Sushrut, Aryabhatta, Varahmihir, Bhaskaracharya, Brahmagupta, Chanakya, Chakrapani Datta, Panini, Patanjali, Nagarjun, Gautama, Pingala, Sankardevu, Maitreyi, Gargi, Thiruvalluvar, and many more, many more. So when this policy is endorsing, recommending, suggesting, the policy is having these institutions and these scholars in the frame of reference. And therefore the policy itself is starting the part of higher education by citing certain problems. These problems which I am going to share with you is written in the policy, and I am sure that those who are attending today, those who are listening this discourse today, they are having the policy in their hands, and they can read these problems from the policy. So what the major problems this policy is highlighting is, the policy is saying we have severely fragmented higher educational ecosystem. The policy is saying that there is a less emphasis on development of cognitive skill and learning outcome. The policy is focusing on rigid separation of discipline. The policy is focusing on citing the problem of that excess of higher education institutions in particularly in socio-economically disadvantaged areas, who teaches in local languages. Limited teacher and institutional autonomy is another problem. Inadequate mechanism for merit-based career management progression is another problem. Then lesser emphasis on research at most universities and colleges. Suboptimal governance, ineffective regulatory system, large affiliating universities are few problems which have been listed by this policy itself. And you can visit, you can see this policy to understand the problems. Because I'm again quoting Dr. Dev Kumar Mukherjee ji, who said that this is the high time when we need to work on Ranniti. So when you will be in a position to discuss on Ranniti, when you will be in a position to discuss on effective program of action, when you will be in a position to discuss on plan of action, you will be in a position only when you will be understanding the problems, when you will be understanding the recommendations of policy, so you may visit these problems. Now, this for higher education, this policy is again taking reference from ancient Indian literary work such as Banabhatta's Kadamburis, 64 Kalas. And these 64 Kalas includes singing, painting, scientific field, vocational field, professional field, soft skills, all the fields these 64 Kalas are incorporating. Therefore, we need to understand when we are going to work on liberal arts. Then this policy is focusing on multi-entry and exit point. They are saying that after 1 year of completion, they will be provided certificate. After 2 years, they may be provided a diploma. After 3 years, bachelor's degree. But the policy is focusing on 4 year multidisciplinary bachelor program. One more thing which our students need to understand that this 4 year program may also lead to a degree with the research. You need to, those students who are listening today, they need to understand that this 4 year bachelor degree program may also lead to a degree with the research. When a student completes a rigorous research project in their major area of study. And the policy is focusing on model public universities for holistic and multidisciplinary education, which they are calling MERU, multidisciplinary education and research universities. What Shubhajit Ghosh was telling in his opening remark, that they are going to break many silos and they are going to convert all the institutions into multidisciplinary institutions. Along with those conversion, they are coming up with this MERU's multidisciplinary education and research university, which the policy is saying these institutions will be at par with IITs and IIMs. And therefore, you need to understand the importance of IDPs, Institutional Development Plan. Because three institutions are collaborating today to organize this webinar. So all these institutions need to understand that keeping in view the upcoming changed governance, you need to focus on institutional development plans. In short, we are calling it IDPs. So on the basis of IDPs, you will be in a position to get funds, to get to different courses, different programs, because the policy is simultaneously working on phasing out affiliation system. So maybe if your college has potential, maybe one day you can become an autonomous college who can award your own degree. So therefore you need to work on your IDPs. The policy is recommending that all such programs, courses, curriculum, pedagogy, assessment, etc., institution needs to work. Why? Because we need to achieve global standards of quality. So because I could see from your flyer, from your brochure, that all the education departments are involved. Therefore, all the education departments must come out to work on curriculum, to work on pedagogies, to work on assessments, so that we can suggest plenty of parameters. Now, this whole policy is bringing a paradigm shift so far as regulation and governance is concerned. Therefore, the policy is saying that for regulation, for accreditation, for funding, and for academic standards for four purposes: regulation, accreditation, funding, and academic standards. For these four purposes, the policy is saying that there will be four vertical bodies. There will be four vertical bodies. And all these four vertical bodies will be working under the umbrella body, which will be known as HECI, Higher Education Commission of India. So all the four vertical bodies for regulation, for accreditation, for funding, and for academic standards. The first vertical body of HECI will be NHERC, National Higher Education Regulatory Council. And all the regulations for higher education will be taken care by this first vertical body, which is known as NHERC. This is the first vertical body to HECI, Higher Education Commission of India. The second vertical body will be NAC, National Accreditation Council. This body will be taking care of all accreditation, and this will be the second vertical of HECI, which is an umbrella body. The third vertical of Higher Education Commission of India, that is HECI, will be HEGC, Higher Education Grants Council, and this will be taking care of grants. And then the fourth vertical body for HECI will be GEC, General Education Council. That means all these four bodies, NHERC, NAC, HEGC, GEC, all four vertical bodies will be taking care regulation, accreditation, grants, and academic standards. And all these four works will be taken care under an umbrella body, which will be known as Higher Education Commission of India, HECI. And now, for this reason, all such professional councils which are existing as on date, like you say, ICAR, VCI, NCTE, COA, NCVET, all such professional councils now will be working as PSSBs, Professional Standard Setting Bodies. And mind it, my dear friends, these professional standard setting bodies now will be the member of fourth vertical of HECI, that is GEC, General Education Council. Now, as Dr. Dev Kumar Mukherjee said in the beginning itself, now our work begins. We need to understand all the existing framework, all the existing regulations, all the existing provisions, all the existing ordinance, because we are going to work on visionary regulations, provisions, ordinances, which will be of prime importance. Now, another important issue is that the policy is focusing on GER to be 50%, and therefore the policy is going to rely on use of technology, and it is the high time when all the teachers, especially, and when I'm saying it, I mean it, and this there is a and I am saying I'm saying this with a note of caution all the human resources, especially working in government structure, they need to wake up now. If you will not wake up now, system is going to work against you. So policy is an alarm. So therefore, what I was saying is the policy is going to rely on technology. So you all need to work, you all need to learn, you all need to cope up with the technological advancements. Another important issue is the policy is focusing on credit transfer and academic bank of credit. Credit transfer and academic bank of credit. And for this reason, a massive reorientation is required. Massive reorientation is required. Since massive orientation is required, therefore, I again request all the three institutions which are collaborating today, or I am requesting all the departments of education to come out, to take lead. To take lead so far as massive reorientation on such issues are concerned. Now, this policy is recommending on NRF, National Research Foundation. So, the policy is saying that at current time, and we all know, when I was in Shantiniketan, I was reading a newspaper, and the front page newspaper news was for the standard of research, the front page news was tiger in graduate and rat in research. Since I have read this line, I am quoting this line almost all in all my fresh or new lectures. Tiger in graduate and rat in research. Since we are aware on the standards of research, therefore the policy is saying itself that we are, as on date, we are not spending enough amount on researches. For example, the policy is saying that right now we are spending only 0.69% of GDP as compared to 2.8% of USA, 4.3% in Israel, and 4.2% in South Korea. That means we are much below than America, than Israel, than South Korea. And therefore, this NRF is going to take care of all such issues. And I'm happy to share with you that NRF is not going to discriminate between a university or a college. Therefore, all the stakeholders, all the important members, especially teaching community, need to work on their researches, their IDPs, their programs, their proposals, so that all the colleges may be converted into an autonomous college, further into a teaching university, further into a research university, because this policy is suggesting that affiliated colleges, then autonomous colleges, the teaching university to research university. So every institution has that potential. Every institution has that that kind of essence. Only thing is, we need to initiate, we need to come out. So NRF is there. Then we have certain questions. For example, the policy is focusing on fragmenting and the fragmentation of higher education. So what will be the roadmap of transforming higher education institutions into a large multidisciplinary universities? So then we need to, we all know that teaching and research is having symbiotic relationship. Since teaching and research is having symbiotic relationship, therefore, what will be the roadmap for research intensive university or also to say teaching intensive universities? What will be the roadmap for granting graded autonomy to colleges? What will be the roadmap for colleges to be upgraded to teaching university or research university? So on all such issues, we are going to work. One more thing, that we all understand that policies focusing on 50 to achieve 50% GER, and I have already told you that it is going to rely on technology. The policy is saying that conventional institutions will be given the component of ODL on open distance learning along with on different online platforms. So the through this we are going to achieve GER. Now, these are some wonderful suggestions, and if you read this policy, you will be whatever good suggestions you can imagine, the policy is having those suggestions. But the thing is, how we are going to convert these suggestions into an actionable action, because until and unless we will be having actionable actions, these policies will be decorating our libraries only. Now, because I have very less time in my hand, so I'll be covering in 2-3 minutes only. Now, the policy is saying one more very important thing, that the policy will be working on common standards for public and private institutions. So when this policy is recommending, I'm having my own apprehensions, because implementing common standards and norms will be needing extra assertive political will. I am repeatedly saying these things because I have gone through one article in a newspaper which suggests that between 2010 to 2015, on an average, 6 institutions were opened every day, including Saturdays and Sundays. And majority of these institutions, majority of such institutions belong to the politicians, belong to the supporters of politicians, belong to the middle-sized businessmen, belong to the property dealers, etc. And if you see a large segment of poor or below average institutions which are being run in small cities, small towns, villages, and sometimes you will be finding in major cities also are being owned by these set of people. So therefore, when the policy is conceiving the idea of common standards, the idea is really good. I'm not at all saying that it is impossible, but yes, it will be really difficult. It will be really challenging. For this reason, all state governments, irrespective of their political ideology, will have to tie their hands so that common standards and norms will be implemented. And as I am saying repeatedly, that implementation of such things, common standards and norms, and 6% GDP will be needing extra assertive political will. I'm repeating once again. Therefore, as with every policy, we have seen many policies, every policy, the real test will be in its translation from policy to action. And therefore, Dr. Deb Kumar Mukherjee rightly said that we need to work on Ranniti. And in order to work on Ranniti, we need to understand this policy. We need to reflect over policies. So with these words, I would stop here. Thank you so much, Shubhajit Kumar Ghosh. Thank you so much, all the three institutions. Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity. Thank you, one and all. Thank you so much. Over to the organizer.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for sharing your valuable insights on new education policy. You have truly said that in terms of quality, we are far behind the global level. If I took back an example of PISA ranking 2015, we can see that we are not able to compete with the developed countries so far. Bitter truth, but we have to admit it. Sir, we are struggling to complete our prescribed syllabus within the stipulated time till now, rather than focusing on the mastery over the subject. The reason behind is this is to prepare our students for the passing of exam. Knowingly or unknowingly, we are focusing on giving priority for rote learning or rote memorization skills, etc. So what I say that NEP 2020 is reality now. We have to accept it and admit it too. No other choice. आप अक्सर कहते थे कि बिल्ली के गले में घंटे घंटा बांधेगा कौन? तो बिल्ली भी हाजिर है, घंटा भी तो हम लोग हाथ में पकड़ा गया है. तो how to bell the cat? So we are the stakeholders have to decide the roadmap for implementations. Sir, before going to the question and answer session, I have two questions to you. In new education policy, point number 10.1 to 10.11, it is clearly mentioning about removing fragmentation in higher education and transforming unitary university to multidisciplinary universities. But sir, how could it possible? Because most of the institutions across the India are unitary in nature, because we have IFLU in Hyderabad, Ambedkar University in Delhi, Sanskrit University in Kolkata, and IITs and IIMs are also law colleges are there. So how could it possible? This is my first question. And second question, what should be the roadmap for curriculum transactions? according to the new education policy. That means how to design the curriculum. Does it follow the traditional way as it was, or there should be any changes observed in the basic course development? What do you think, sir?
Number one, there are plenty of standalone institutions, unitary institutions. So where it is not possible, they are going to formulate clusters of higher education institutions, number one. Number two is, for example, IITs and IIMs, who are not only having a scope, but having infrastructure, having that kind of potential to convert into a multidisciplinary institutions. So all such institutions will be converted. Where it is not possible, clusters will be formed. Clusters of higher education institutions will be formed, number one. Number two is, your second question was, what will be the change in the curriculum? So, see, and now this policy is suggesting for credit transfer and academic bank of credit. So, I am sure that a task force has been appointed by different governments, central government, different institutions, like you are working today. So different institutions are suggesting. So keeping in view a broad framework of curriculum, we will be reorienting our curriculum. This is one point. Second point is, the policy is saying that our curriculum is really crowded one. So we will be converting into a feasible one, achievable one. As you said in your remark, that our whole concern is on completing the syllabus. And this is the concern which is posed by society and parents only. So we will be reworking on curriculum. And that is why I said in my lecture in between that I'm requesting all the departments of education across India to come out, because they are having, I'm not saying that other departments are not having their understanding, but education department, because they deal with curriculum, they deal with pedagogy, they deal with assessment. So they need to come out to work in collaboration with the other departments, other disciplines of the existing institutions. So in such way, curriculum will be revisited.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. So now I move to the question answer session. So many questions has been asked by the participants. First questions has been asked by Pranob Potto Joshi. Do you think the abolition of MPhil degree is right? I think it is a gateway for research work. The UGC guideline 2009 and 2014 clearly emphasizes on the coursework. Is quality will improve by removing MPhil from NEP?
I cannot comment on what will happen to quality. I cannot comment really. But what I personally believe is that four-year program, after this program, you may enter into a degree program. The program is being structured in such a way where the four-year degree program will be known as four-year degree program with research, where if the student is opting this program, the student will be needing to complete a rigorous research project in their major areas. So this will be the option only for those students who are aspiring for researches in time to come. So if, for example, if I am entering into a graduation and I believe that I will be entering into the research in area of research in future, so I will be taking a four-year bachelor's program with research degree. So this will be healing that which we are going to lose from MPhil.
Yes. Okay, he has asked another question. Are primary and secondary students participating in teacher evaluation or performance appraisal?
So far as teachers' appraisal is concerned, Students' feedback is being considered at every level. And now, recently, I had an interaction with one premier university of India, and that university is working on indicators, on different indicators of appraisal. So, but yes, peer rating, student rating, and then self-rating, all are going to be the part of teacher appraisal.
Okay. And he has asked another question. Would research on foreign language education done globally be beneficial to design local policies, and to what extent? Would research on foreign language education done globally be beneficial to design local policies? If it is, then what extent?
When we are dealing with research on foreign languages, it is specifically to deal with that foreign languages and to update. For example, plenty of employees are working in different embassies. So working on different foreign languages is not going to affect our local policies. So the research in particular language is going to upgrade those understanding.
Okay, then one of your student, my brother Suman from NUPA, has asked, sir, you have talked about several challenges that the policy has posed, but don't you think the policy is silent regarding teachers recruitment? We already lack of teachers in higher education institutions.
No. Policy is not silent on teacher recruitment. Policy is in the very beginning, policy is saying that teachers will be at center, and policy is saying that massive recruitment drives will be taken on board soon. So see, ultimately, yes, policy is there. Ultimately, how it, for example, one more thing I forgot to share, that Meru, they have recommended Meru. So when I was recommending, when I was telling on Meru, I think I have missed it, that we need to ensure human resources, physical resources, infrastructural resources in time. Yes, I agree with the concern of Suman Saha, that teacher recruitment is a crucial process, but policy is somehow showing intent on appointing the teachers, and the policy is showing that teachers must be at center. This is very in the very beginning policy has written. Now we need to look at its implementation.
So, sir, he has asked another question. Policy is talking about teachers' low motivation. I think sir has disconnected. Midulla, can you assure me that sir is here or not?
Shubhajit, okay. There was some disruption of connection. Can you repeat?
Okay. One more question from Suman, that policy is talking about teachers' low motivations, but don't you think that the policy is silent regarding how to motivate teachers?
Yes, this is a very relevant and very genuine concern of Suman Saha. Even I am thinking in the same line, that the if you see this the goodish intent of this policy, the major part of such intentions are going to be achieved by teachers only, and on this part we are lacking severely. So until and unless we will be reorienting our teachers, and when I was suggesting the challenges, I raised one challenge: raising aspirations. So this raising aspiration is a challenge. Don't have any suggestions to make right now, but yes, this is a point of great concern.
Okay. And another question is asked by Arun Das. What will be the role of Open University after NEP 2020?
ODL, Open Universities will be there. Open Universities will be there. The policy is suggesting that different conventional universities will be given the component of ODL after due accreditation. So Open Universities will be there, as well as ODL component will be given to conventional institutions. See, I'm very frankly saying this thing. As per 2018, the GER was 26.3%. By 2035, the policy is taking this GER to 50%. So we are going to rely heavily on technology and the ODL.
Okay. We are running out of time. Then just taking a last questions from Hanif Iqbal. What is your opinion on one language up to class 5? Is it will be a reason for or barrier in higher education?
No, I didn't
What is your opinion on one language up to the class 5? Is it will be a reason or barrier for higher education?
No, question is not clear. Question is not clear. But policy is saying that regional language, mother tongue, you know, language for languages, this policy is really liberal.
Okay.
Even many higher education institution will be taken care by local languages.
Okay. Last question. The commerce asked by Choitali Ghosh. The commercialization of education is one of the important aspects in this present time. Then what will be the suggestions regarding this matter if you are thinking about quality education? The commercialization of education.
I think Chaitali has missed my last statement, which I said that majority of the institutions are being run by politicians, supporters of politicians, middle class businessmen, and property dealers, and the number is truly large. So in order to implement these common standards, so from government side, from policy side, policy is saying that there will be a common standard, common norms for all the institutions. So from government side, government is clear. Now the only thing is Chaitali's concern can be taken care by implementing this idea of having common standards and norms for both institutions in our program of action, in our implementation will make it a success. Otherwise, commercialization will be growing like anything.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir, for being with us, spending few minutes, sharing your thoughts with us. It is regardless to say that your lecture is always enlightening to us, igniting and inspiring the young minds also. Helps them to find out a new research area or new research problem. Thank you, sir, for your eye-opening lecture. Thank you. Now I would like to invite the convener of this webinar, Mr. Midullah, to take charge of this session.
Now, Dr. Tapon Hajra, PIC of Gurabgu Memorial College is with us. I request him to say a few words about this webinar.
Thank you. I am audible?
Yes, sir.
Am
yes.
I audible? Thank
yes,
you.
Sir.
I would congratulate the seminar topic on National Education Policy 2020 challenges and opportunities. I would like to thank to Mr. Dr. S.K. Bose, the principal of Shampur Siddheshwari College, and Dr. Dev Kumar Mukherjee, Ram Shadoy College, Howrah, both of Howrah. And also I like to congratulate all the departments of three college, departments of education of three colleges, Shampukur Siddheshwari College, Ram Shadoy College, and our college, Gaurav Gwin Memorial College. And also the convener of this webinar, Dr. Shikanto Nundi and Dr. Midul Ghosh, and organizing secretaries, Dr. Pankaj Kumar Pal and Mr. Subhajit Ghosh. And also, I like to congratulate all of us engaged in our webinar committee. Now, let us talk with the National Education Policy 2020. I would say that after the 34 years, the Union government had published the National Education Policy after 1986. after 34 years. I think it has it is the right time to take the challenges. And India, we are only hearing that India is lag very far behind the world, the industrial countries in the educational sector. Now, the main focus of this education system is 2020, the Indian higher education moved to 25% to 50% of our education, on our education. And it has been also challenged, it has been also emphasis on the practical education rather than the theoretical education. And it also challenged the importance to other subjects. Now, when this education system will be run, and it will be India a global knowledge superpower. The higher education has the problem. We are working in the higher education. We know that there's lots of problems in the higher education. The existence of multiple entry, the students continue after dropping the first semester, and the certificate in every year, and the bachelor degree with the research, with the research work, all these are very available. But I think this system is trying to spout the American system in Indian soil. It is a very challenge for us. How we will do in Indian soil, that is the main question. And I think the speakers, congratulate the Ashish Srivastava, is a very good, he had very good lecture, and we are delighted by his lecture. And I would like to thank Mr. Nabokumar Mondol, the last recent speaker. Now, my way to in my speech and over to the convener of this seminar, Mr. Mridul Ghosh. Thank you every day. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, sir. Now I will request Dr. Srikant Nondi to address our next speaker, Dr. Nabokumar Mondol, sir.
Now, am I audible? Mridul Babu? Hello? Hello?
You are perfectly audible. Hello, and visible too. Continue, audible? Please continue. Yes.
Now we are going to the second session of today's webinar on National Education Policy 2020, Challenges and Opportunities. The National Education Policy 2020 is focused on access, equity, quality, affordability, and accountability of the education system of the country. One of the major recommendations of the National Education Policy 2020 is the transdisciplinary and multidisciplinary approach, which will be reflected in the education and research in India in the coming days. The speaker of our second session today is such a personality. Even though he is currently deeply involved in environmental science, he has shown through his research how environmental pollution can affect education. Needless to say, ignorance of the environment is pushing us towards darkness. This is because we have fallen into the pandemic like COVID-19. And as a result of not giving importance to the environment, now we are being forced to exchange our knowledge through webinars, not by traditional seminars. This man is one of the exemplary personalities of how the importance of environment can be brought to education. And he is Professor Dr. Nabokumar Mondol, the speaker of the second session of today's webinar. Dr. Nabokumar Mondol is currently holds the position of professor and head in Environmental Science, Department of Environmental Science, the University of Burdwan. He completed his postgraduate in chemistry from Department of Chemistry and doctorate degrees in Environmental Science Department from the Department of Environmental Science, University of Bordhawan. Professor Mandal established a resourceful, high-quality environmental chemistry lab in the department, having quality research instruments. He has published his research work more than 200 reputed international and national journals. Since date, he guided 17 PhD, among them 13 have been awarded. Moreover, he also guided more than 50 MSc thesis and 2 MPhil fellow. Since today, he had 11 research projects in his name as a principal investigator and or co-principal investigator, which amounts more than 1.7 crore from various funding agencies like DST, Government of India, UGC, West Bengal DST, ICAR, ICSSR, etc. His primary research interests are adsorption chemistry by low cost absorbance, water quality degradation, and management of arsenic and fluoride affected areas of West Bengal, indoor air pollution and human health and hygiene, nanotechnology, mosquito control, mobile tower radiations and its impact on human health, and also teacher education. Professor Mandal has delivered several invited talks and keynote addresses in national and international conferences of high repute. He had chaired various international national seminars and conferences. He served as coordinator of UGC-sponsored various refresher courses and also secretary member of West Bengal DST-sponsored Science Congress. Professor Mandal also served as a head examiner and invigilator of various nationalized examination, number of interview panel of recruitment of faculty members of environmental science. He has been nominated as reviewer of reputed publication houses like Elsevier, Springer, Taylor and Francis, etc. Now, I am inviting him to deliver his lecture. Please, sir, come. Over to sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Nandi. At the outset, I must express my sincere thanks and my pranam to the all faculty members and all the principals of the three different colleges. Principal Sir Dr. S.K. Bose from Shyampur Siddheshwari Mahavidyalaya. Principal Sir Dr. Tapan Hajra. Principal Sir Dr. Dev Kumar Mukherjee. It is really an important webinar, which was organized by the collaboration of these three colleges. Really, I am very much excited to take part in this webinar, because this is the high time to, you know, discuss a little bit about our, you know, national policy of education 2020. See, policy say many things. Policy gives many points, but we have to decide our strategy, as Dr. Dev Kumar Mukherjee says that we have to, you know, prepare ourselves. But what actually our reality? We have to prepare ourselves according to our needs. Many things can be there. Many things may be prescribed by the different, you know, educationalist, the different policy maker. But we have to adjust it. We have to regulate it. We have to optimize it according to, you know, computer language. We have to optimize it. Otherwise, we may not acquainted or we may not welcome to our, you know, new policy. So first of all, at the very beginning, I express my gratitude to all the teachers from the different colleges of education and computer science department Sampur Siddheshwari Mahavidyalaya, Department of Education Ram Sadai College, Department of Education of Gaurav Guin Memorial College in association with the IQSE of the aforesaid colleges. And also, I must express my deep gratitude to today's speaker, Professor Ashish Srivastava. He is an eminent educationalist. Right now, he is in the dean of a school of education, Mahatma Gandhi Central University, East Champaran, Bihar. Professor Srivastava has mentioned everything, so nothing is left. But I am fortunate enough that Professor Srivastava can confine his, you know, just his particular discussion on higher education. Therefore, definitely he has deliberately given some, you know, area to discuss in the, you know, primary education or secondary education. Thank you, sir. However, we are getting this big policy, but it is very difficult to digest the each and every point of this policy. All the listener, all the research scholar, all the faculty member has, you know, have a, you know, enormous question, enormous, you know, confusion regarding this particular policy. But first of all, you have to digest that the what actually want to say. This policy can give in some points what actually the policy says. Okay, so I like to share my, you know, presentation. So I think somebody will help me. Now it is, you know, it is okay.
Sir, it's okay.
Is it visible?
Yes, yes, yes. Very much visible.
Okay, okay, okay. Thank you. Thank you, Pankaj. See, this one day national webinar was giving the name of National Education Policy 2020 Challenges and Opportunities. I must say that the organizer is really very, very sensitive, because they realize that this is the high time to discuss about this new policy 2020, and really they have given the nomenclature NEP 2020 challenges and opportunities. Really many challenges are there, lot of challenges are there, and simultaneously lot of opportunities is also there. Whatever the opportunities is there, okay, we have to find out that, but what are the challenges are there? Many researchers, I hope that many researchers are listening this webinar. Many teachers, you know, many college professors, they are, you know, just going through this webinar, and they can formulate their research problem from this webinar. I have also formulated some of the research problem whenever I go on through this. Remember, it is very difficult because I am wholeheartedly in the environmental education. But once it was published in the cabinet meeting, and then and there I go through the different, you know, newspaper and the different news published by the, you know, human research MHRD department, and they are releasing a lot of information. We are going through this as we are in teaching profession. So forget about that, whether you are in education department, and that is proved by the organizer, because just look the composition of the organizer. That is a computer science department. The education department is there because it is their subject, but you don't feel that it is their own subject. The subject is for everyone. So thank you for the computer science department. And I must welcome to the other department also. Please go through this, you know, policy to learn something. What are the difficulties? What are the problems? What are the barriers we will face if we follow, total follow this particular policy, what should be, because ultimately you have to implement this policy. So you have to realize the ground reality. Until and unless you realize your ground reality, then you may not be able to apply or, you know, acquaintate or, you know, welcome this particular policy. So that is why this is the right time to discuss. And, you know, I hope that you are aware that tomorrow there will be a governor's conference regarding this new policy, you know, 2020. The governor's conference will be held by a, you know, high committee where our prime minister will be present, our education minister will present, and all will discuss about this. So you are also, you know, I think you are the, you know, you are the pioneer of this. Because in West Bengal, I don't know, I am far away from that, but you are the first time trying to, you know, to present such a webinar by, you know, with the help of this, you know, eminent, you know, professor, Professor Srivastav sir. Really, Professor Srivastav sir has a very critical mind, very critically judging all and every point. But due to the time constraint, he is not able to go through each and every point. He has touched all these points. And the listener make a lot of questions in a very deep sense. This is the actual reality, and this is the time for this. This particular discussion is needed. So, you see, as this policy, we are, you know, nurturing with this policy, I think it is better to say that how this policy, you know, come to us. That's why I'm giving the name. It's a long journey. Really, it's a long journey. How you can call it a long journey? Yes, this policy was formed through a long journey. Just look this slide. And look this road map. Then, you know, after the probably it is the Lok Sabha election 2014, there after the 2015 there's a draft policy was framed, and subsequently it is in 2016 and 2017 2017 that draft education policy was framed by the different educationalists, where the leadership given by the Dr. K. Kasturi Rangan is a chief scientist from ISRO. Under the chairmanship of Dr. K. Kasturi Rangan, giving this particular, you know, policy, but remember that policy was based on some scientific outcome. The policy, if you go to the MHRD, you know, MHRD website, you can find a photograph. Just you realize this photograph, why MHRD choose this photograph in their website over this MHRD Human Resource Development the Department. The nomenclature has been changed to this, you know, right now that, you know, education, that the department, Ministry of Education, that changes to the Ministry of Education. Anyway, so if you go to the website, you can find this picture and you can realize, listener, specifically students, specifically researcher, you can think that why this photograph given in their website. Well, this is your query. Now, if you look very minutely with a high resolving microscope to this particular NAP 2020, you can find many points and many things. What are that many things and many points? Really, if you go to this point, you find that this is the policy, how the policy ladder and the policy ultimately come to us. Ultimately, we are waiting for this wonderful policy. We are waiting at least 34 years. We are waiting at least 34 years after 1986 to 2020. We are getting. So we are waiting 34. But remember, each and every day there is a new problem. Each and every day there is a new situation arise. So all things are not possible to include in this new policy. But as far as possible, they are trying to include in this new policy. Remember, many of the educationalists, they are finding new questions and new queries regarding this particular policy. But remember, this policy is absolutely based on whatever I call, this policy is absolutely based on the scientific outcome. How the policy is framed, I will come to this point critically. Let us have a look. Already, Professor Srivastava sir mentioned that this policy has a distinct four parts. Well, but main concern of our discussion is the school education and higher education. How we will nurture it, how we will welcome this, that will come to the later on. But this is very important, how we can deal this new policy, which is adopted, which is given by our educationalist policymakers about the school education and the higher education. But first of all, this education deal with some of the points. This is very, very remarkable transformation. I must say it is really a transformation. It is really a revamp. It is really a revamp. Why? Because you know that the new policy tries to establish or tries to giving some information to us that we have to achieve, we have to acquire that 100% GER, gross enrollment ratio. Now the question is that is there any difficulties? Is there any difficulties in preschool and secondary education? Why this particular policy called that 100% gross enrollment ratio is essential? Yes, lot of informations are there, and it is that the different government and private agencies, they are doing research, and they call that it is a real situation that the age of a student having the age of 10 years or more, they are unable to read the text. They are unable to do any mathematical function, any mathematical operation. They are unable to do this. Well, this is a learning crisis. That is a very important point, that is called a learning crisis. And this situation is given by the World Bank called learning poverty. World Bank called the situation is a learning poverty. And this learning poverty, how we can achieve this, how we can come out of this situation. I hope you may recall the National Achievement Survey. In National Achievement Survey, NAS, they call that within our India, there is at least 12 states where more than 5 crore students, this is the children, they are unable to read, unable to do any mathematical operation. So just realize that. So all this is why, as per the report of the National Achievement Survey, NAS, I must request to everyone, those are listening, please go to the National Achievement Survey website to get the data, secondary data, even do a lot of research you can do in this line. So that is why they are decided that yes, GER should be achieved. How to achieve? How it can be fulfilled? That's the point of discussion. That's the strategy. As Professor Kumar Mukherjee mentioned, that we have to equip ourselves to fight against it, to welcome it. Until and unless you equip yourself, you may not welcome this new policy. You have to develop your, you have to modernize your cognitive structure so that you can very easily accept it. Otherwise, at a glance, this will behave just like a canvas ball. You throw this ball to the ball will immediately return. If you use this national policy, even at a glance, that policy like that, just like reflection, just like can be called reflection. Okay, that is it. But you have to consider, you have to read it very properly. See, another point. There is a gross enrollment ratio should be in 2080. It is probably said 26.43 like that. Two, that should be increased to 50% by 2030. Already, Professor Srivastava sir mentioned that. How we can achieve this? This is a big question. Big question. And that is the challenge. I must salute to the all three colleges organizer, all organizer, that they have given the nomenclature challenges and opportunities. That's the ground reality. We have to take the challenge to achieve it. Okay. Now, the most important point which we actually discuss in this particular, particular policy, that is the shifting of 10+2 system, preschool, secondary education, pre-education and secondary education, that goes to from 10+2 system to 10+2 system to 5+3+3+4 system. Now all the educationalists, all the researchers, all the scientists, all the principals and all the faculty members from the different departments, they are thinking that is it required? What was the wrong in 10+2 system? Why this system is come? That will be a research problem. Anybody can do the research. I am request to the faculty member from the education department, you can do the research and you can find out some new points. You can get a new information, new data. Come to this point, that how this 10+2 system, or what are the shifted to these 5+3+3+4 system? Is there any problem? You have to discuss, you have to think very critically. See, 10+2 system, if you goes to 10+2 system to a high resolving power microscope, you can find that yes, something is there and some problem is there. What are the problem? And that problem is visualized by the new policy. That is a division of the 5+3+3+4. Now the question is that, for my understanding, I just draw this picture. I did just draw the picture on the simple white sheet. You see, this is 6 to 14. This 6 to 14 years age, that was the prior compulsory education, pre and compulsory education. We have to do this 6 to 14 years. Now the scale is enhanced. The six ages, that is entry age 6, is go beyond to the 6, that is goes to 3 years, and the 14 age is goes to the 18 years. Okay, it go to the 18 years. Now the question is that why the policymaker come to down? Why the policymaker come to get down this area? But that means this 3 years, why 6 below 6 years, that is the 5 years, 4 years, 3 years, and they have decided that 3 years may be the entry point. Now the anybody can raise the question, why 3 years taken? In this way you can critically judge. See, there is a lot of scientific report, lot of neurological study. They are experts from the different medical center, different medical doctors, different medical scientists. They are told that this 3 years age are vital age because that brain growth and development have started on and from 3 years onward. So why not we utilize this age group to inculcate something so that learner can learn something in this age? And there is a lot of scientific report, lot of neurological study that establish that these 3 years age is vital, 3 years and onward, that in this, you know, time period, if the learner can start from this time, they can recapitulate, they can keep in mind, they can learn many things from this period. So it is very easy to inculcate all these points, whatever the policy decided. This is the right time and this is the right age, you know, skill where the learner can be welcome to this, and we should not waste this time period. Remember, although the life expectancy is in place, many researches indicate that our life expectancy increases on an average 18 years. There is a report in the 2020, recently I read that, life expectancy means amara jo amader je beche thakar shomoy kal sei shomoy kal on an average 18 bochor bere geche. So amara why not we are utilizing this, you know, scale, why not we utilizing this time scale? Well, point. So this 3 years is really vital, and utilizing these 3 years, the many thing can be incorporated, many thing can be, you know, dictated to the learner so that they can easily grasp it and they can learn. Remember, this is the high time to think about that, why we are far away from your own research to get the some recognition, to get the recognition that whenever you are doing something, you know, you are not get your patent. You can go to the, you know, website to see that how many patents are submitted from India and how many patents are submitted from USA in a year, how many patents are submitted from China in a year. You will get a distinct clear-cut difference that something different in India. The Indian mind are not so, you know, fertile, not so fertile. It is my experience that when the learner come to us, when the students come to us, sir, I am interested to do some research. Well, okay, from where you are coming, from which department you are coming, and from which university you are coming, okay. Now, I likely to, you know, giving this some of the talks that, okay, you can go through some of the, you know, paper, some of the article, and then next week and or after 2 weeks, you can come to my lab to discuss that what topics you are feeling, you know, what is your sensitization. I have to realize that. Until and unless I don't get any repercussion, any sparking from your mind, I am not permitted to do any research. The most of the cases, see, right now, the 13 research scholar already awarded and 14 is likely to submit, but you know, 15 and 16 are waiting. Remember, not a single, not a single students are come forward me to say that, sir, I have to do such and such research. This is my interest area. They are molding in such a way that you have to provide some ready-made things. You have to provide some ready-made document. They are capturing it. They are inculcating it. They are, you know, recapitulate and, you know, memorize it and giving the reproduction. That is why you just look towards a big area where from where the patent, from where the Nobel laureate, why the Nobel laureate are chora chori in US? Why the Nobel laureate are chora chori in Germany? Why the Nobel laureate are chora chori in Italy? What are the difference with this, you know, India and USA? Listen, you are giving, demanding that, sir, it is the our population. Go back to this point. that we are not formulate our ideas. We are not taking the, you know, how we can proceed, how we can, you know, acquire this knowledge. And that is why we are not getting such a high percentage of patent. We are always thrusting up, you know, publication. We are always thrusting up research paper. Okay, that is another thing. Well, so this is the crisis. No student, you will get very rare 0.0001% students will be there. They are doing something in their own, but they are far away from this. That is the problem. And, you know, everything they are kept in mind and they are just utilizing their, you know, sub topic to the time of exam. And that is why the examination reform is there. Really, this is needed. And that is the crucial point of this particular policy. I just go through this policy, very simple area, very small area, but I think it very critically. I like this. So this foundational stage they are introducing, that 3 to 6 years is a vital age. And that is why educationalists, policymakers, they are trying to include this 3 to 6 year age in this particular policy. All this is foundational age. And anybody can remember is because the college teacher, principal, sir, and research scholar, they are habituated to the term of PFMS. Nowadays, our project, everything, financial transaction is gone through the PFMS, isn't it? So you just remember the PFMS. That means you can call, the P means, you know, preparatory, F means foundation, M means middle, S means secondary. So PFMS, you can remember. So new policy 5+3+3+4, the division is like this. And that is essential, okay? So I have given, see, what are the challenges? What are the challenges? Challenges is that it is, it's a newspaper. I hope that many of you, you know, regular reader of newspaper, I have taken this newspaper picture from the Anand Bazar Putrika. This is a very widely circulated newspaper. And I am very much acquainted and very much, you know, stick with this, all the, you know, types of newspaper. And I gone through this, you know, judgment, whatever they written there. See, multilingualism and the power of language, they are giving that they, at the age of some critics are criticized. Some, this is essential. Please don't mind that critics terminology. No, this is essential. Some critics, some researchers are raising some of the research point and some of the, you know, big question like that. That how it is possible within the age of 3 they can learn the 3 languages. Remember, please go through the policy to read it very, very minutely. That the learner should be, you know, a transaction, you know, the learning transaction should be that is the communication should be in the regional language, should be in the mother tongue. That is important, and that can be up to the age of 8, up to the age of 5, if it is possible beyond that. Okay, so this is very important. We have to take the challenges, and as much as possible, we have to acquire this, isn't it? See, there is a lot of point, as I mentioned, that we are very, very, from the very beginning, our mind is ready to accept a ready-made thing. Everything, every students are ready to accept the ready-made things. That is why their examination pattern is also like that. And that is why new policy called that, well, we have to transform the assessment from the, you know, rote learning to the assessment of the formative style. That is the ongoing process. Whatever you learn, you have to give the some of the feedback. If until and unless you're giving the feedback, and that may not be, you know, crystallized, that may not be, you know, cementing, because the policymaker tries to establish that the learner should increase their higher order thinking skill, increase their critical thinking, increase their conceptual clarity, that should be developed. That should be developed among the learner. And that is why the new policy called that the examination reform. That examination reform, this should be a formative style of evaluation. That is not based on the rote learning. That is not based on the rote learning. Look at the picture. This is really, we have to remove this rote learning practice. We are always dealing with the, you know, textbook. We are always dealing with the textbook. Forget about, and once upon a time when I was in education department, I was spending at least 10 years or more than 10 years in education department. At that time, I believed that education, you know, is every school and colleges, there should have only the blackboard or, you know, chalkboard and a small cell to keep the article. Not a chair and, you know, table or chair and, you know, table where the teacher can sit. Because you have to allot only 45 or 40 minutes, you have to engage with the student. You have to engage with the student. And the student may not be worried about the textbook. Well, textbook, you can keep in mind the point, then go to the library, you can use your textbook. You can go back to your home to use your textbook and to make that what new point you are getting, you have to note down. Because we are discussing something nowadays, you know, in my class, and you are keeping only your exercise book and pen. That is enough to you. So there is no question of, school bag weight. School bag weight. I have a research paper also. I have done the research, school bag weight. How tremendously the school bag weight are affecting on the learning outcome. Well, forget it. So see, this type of rote learning should be avoided. And this new policies is really, really emphasizing this point. Because until and unless we are making this rote learning, but there is some point how this rote learning is avoided. This is not given in the, you know, new NEP 2020. And that is why some critics are raising the question that the policy is really silent in this line. Policies are really silent. They are not telling anything about that. What they are telling? You have to realize this. What should you do? You have to realize this. So this is a very important point that the examination reform is ready. We need a joyful learning. But remember, it's not a textbook language. It is not restricted in the textbook. It should be implemented in the class. Well, you can tell me that the lot of students, I have a 200 student in my class. How it is possible? It is possible. And that type of training is needed. How to control the 200 and more students in your class. And that is why in higher education, there is a part of that educational department, that means in the BA degree, that is in the 4 years degree of the BA, you know, that how the training institute should be developed, what should be the new strategy of the training development, training schools and training department. So joyful learning is needed. And if we do, we have to be equitable and inclusive education. It is a very old terminology, although the terminologies are used in this new policy, but inclusive is really inclusive in what sense? Inclusive in what sense? See, all sorts of difficulties should be overcome. Now come to the, you know, higher education. As Professor Srivastava said, respected sir, he has mentioned many things and many critical ideas in his lecture. Remember, in this higher education, there is a chance to increase the 18% to the 50% within the age of 2035. I think I have made a point 2030 in the at our course. Anyway, so 50% gross enrollment should be there. How it is possible? Some clues are given in the new education policy, NEP 2030. There is the privatization. There is the welcome of the world-class institute so that Indian can be stopped. Already Professor Srivastava sir mentioned this point. Remember, this is really a challenge. I am very much appreciative to you. I'm very much excited to getting this type of title, that is the NEP 2020 challenges and opportunity. Challenges is there. Each and every point there is a challenge. We have to take this challenge. See, some listener already made some of the question. That is the unitary and unitary education. A unitary system can be transformed to a multidisciplinary education. Well, it is also applicable in our research also. Whenever you go to your research, you can find that whenever you can include the one idea in your paper acceptability will be less. Whenever you can include anything in your paper, anything in your research article, then reader can, get some clever, because you are covering every ideas and different points are in your paper. So acceptability your paper will increase. Nowadays, the research that a policymaker trying to convert that unique educational system to a multidisciplinary system because of the concept of our earlier point, where Nalanda Vishwavidyalaya, Nalanda, that is the concept where the system was a multidisciplinary. How the system is formed? Remember, it is the situation and the time frame, everything. This is a real paradigm shift. It is not possible to inculcate or to be included all these points in this particular time period to convert this multidisciplinary education system. Well, as much as possible you can consider. IIT Bombay already considered that the Sanskrit education should be one of the part, isn't it? So at least you can try, because engineering department, they may be involved with engineering. Okay, what are the needs of the social studies? But this is really needed. Educationalists realize that this subject is very important. Social studies is very important. Even you can go through the IIT Kanpur website, you can find that this year GATE exam, which will be held in the 2021 February month, in month of February, GATE exam will occur. GATE exam will help. That GATE exam, you can find that you will be surprised to see that social studies is one of the important points we are considering in this particular year. This is the new time. In this time, they are introducing the social studies in a GATE exam. How it is possible? You just go through the website of the IIT Kharagpur, you can find that there is a department of social studies. This concept is called multidisciplinary. We need this. However, educational policymakers are strictly, deliberately, they are fragmented. This is a law education and the medical education. These are separated. But other parts, as much as possible, you have to consider. Remember, I like to mention this point. You see that ancient time, if you go back to ancient time, where the Gurukul education system is there. I gone through a newspaper paper cutting where one of the principal from Ramakrishna Mission. It is from New Delhi. This is giving the title "New Vision of Shiksha." New Vision of Shiksha. In this title, that the principals had told that we have to recall our Gurukul system. There, the learner learn not only the academic sense. They should learn some other ideas. That academic knowledge, along with some other thing, that should be inculcated among these learners, so that they will be a complete man. Idea behind this, multidisciplinary idea behind this. I just realized that is why. That's why I have taken this photograph. You know, in this higher education system, this is a really, really revamp. I must say it is a revamp. What is that? You see, in undergraduate level, when the students enter to the college, if he or she is engaged with the honors course, that or general course, he or she have to spend at least 3 years. So I just imagine that just you entering in a college means you are entering in a tunnel. Okay, so this tunnel has two. One is exit. Another way you have to entry, and another way there is an exit. So if you enter to the tunnel, you have to spend all these 3 times until and unless you are spending this time, you never exit. And the higher education, this NEP 2020, realized that it is not like that. Is a tunnel, only one entry point, one entry exit, one exit point. It is not justified. We are wasting our resources. And that is why they are giving the idea like that. I have taken a photograph for my imagination. You see, suppose you are entering in a tunnel, that means you are entering in a college in UG level. But after 1 year, suppose you are entering in the college, after 1 year, you may trying to finish your degree. Suppose you will get some degree from this. And your degree may not be lost. You will get a certificate after 1 year. Okay, whenever you go to the spending, then you take the certificate and exit from after 1 year. And that is why there is a different multiple point where you can exit. Okay, if you spend 2 years, then you get the advanced diploma. If you spend 3 years, then you get the UG completion bachelor degree, which is very equivalent to the present situation. Okay, if you spend more than 3 years, that is new, and the interval point, that is 1 year, you can get the diploma. Say you get the certificate. If you spend 2 years, you get the diploma, advanced diploma. If you spend 3 years, you get the bachelor degree, 3 years bachelor degree. Then the new 3rd year, 4th year, that is dedicated for the research. That means if anybody can decide that during from the UG level, he or she can do some of the research oriented work or in higher education to go to the completion of master degree, he or she can spend this 4th year. And this 4th year is dedicated for the research point of view. Okay. After these 4 years, he or she can get the bachelor of research, bachelor with research, bachelor with research. Then, when after spending these 4 years, when this fellow goes to the next higher degree, he or she may do a 1 year master degree. That is enough. If anybody exit after spending 3 years without any doing research oriented, just like a old practice, then he or she May to do 2 years master degree. Just you can clear this point. You see, suppose you are entering college and you decided that you have to take a UG degree. Well, after that 2 years or after spending 1 year, you decided that I am getting a good chance to do some, you know, service or some, you know, employment. Then you can go, no problem. But the time period may not be lost. You will get your certificate after 1 year. You will get your diploma after 2 years. You will get, you know, UG certificate with graduation. This is after 3 years. And everywhere is a station. 1 year, after 1 year, you will get a station. After 2 years, you will get another station. Then you can simply leave or exit. After 3 years, again you can leave if you wish. And after 4 years, if you spend 4 years, then that is up to you. If you get, you know, spend 4 years, then you can get, you know, a UG degree along with, you know, research. Then you can do the master degree. Whenever you go to the master degree, you are entitled to do the master degree of 1 year because you have already spent it there. Remember, everything, you know, very, very scientific, very, very scientific. And there is a less chance to waste the time. And that is why the policymaker giving this idea. And one most important thing, you know, policymaker giving this, and this is really, really needed. This is really, really needed. I have gone through the newspaper and I find that some of the point that the policymaker giving the idea about that nowadays, we are a national agency, national recruitment agencies are there. National recruitment agency. If you are, giving some of the exam for the any employment, and if you score something, and that score is valid for at least 3 years. Now, this new idea, this academic type of credit, that means whatever the credit you are earned, that credit can be you deposit into your locker, just like a bank locker. Okay. And as for this, you know, there should have some agency. I have no clear-cut idea about that. But whatever I perceive from this policy, that there is a, you know, digital locker where the degree can be locked. And if you wish, you can utilize that degree. And the agency will help to utilize this degree. This is really a wonderful and new concept which is implemented, which is, you know, given in this new policy. Single regulatory system. This is needed. Odhik sonnashite kajon noshto. We everybody know that. And that is why it is needed. That is why it is needed. That is the one system should be there. One system should be there. And the all instructions should be forward from this system. And this policy is emphasizing this point. NHERC. That is already, you know, explained by Professor Srivastava. National Research Foundation. This is the point already given by, you know, teacher education, as I mentioned that. Well, this revamp is essential because how to prepare your teacher? If the teacher has no idea how to control and how to, you know, to present a lot, you know, joyful learning, that should be there. So that is why this new policy, given the some of the area that the teacher education should be improved. Well, open and distance learning. Some of the, you know, researcher make the question, and Professor Srivastava sir already given this idea that, yes, distance learning nowadays, it is a distance learning is very important. Right now, you are in the webinar, it is really a distance learning. Whatever we are doing, it's a really, you know, distance learning. And it is really a very popular one. See, today, even in the Prime Minister, in the Education Minister, all are giving the, you know, welcome, or all are, surprised to see that this new normal situation because of the COVID-19, and the all teacher communities, they are giving their effort to online education system, and we are a little bit habituated with this. we are a little bit habituated to this. I just, you know, it's for myself, whenever I giving the first lecture through online system in this new normal situation, that I am not so, you know, flexible enough. But today I feel that I am really flexible. Just I am in the class, and you are just listener. You are listening my lecture. I just like a student. This is my feelings. So it's a virtual, but it is living. I must remember. I must, you know, think like this. So open and distance learning, they are giving the emphasis to this. Online and digital education, really very important. That is also the important point of NEP 2020. They are giving, and Professor Ghosh is there. I mean Professor Ghosh from the computer science department. It is, I think, he's the convener of this program, and he's from computer. So there is real opportunities to do something, to develop some of the software, where we can immediately, you know, contact with this student, you know, point by point. You know, this is really, you know, online education and digital system, there is a, you know, tremendous chance, you know, technology in education. NEP 2020 also emphasis on the point of technology in education. We have to the new technology, we have to develop some technology so that we can giving some of the, you know, accumulate to all the students. Nowadays, it is a very difficult situation. That most of the students are told that they have no, network. Even today, I am giving the lecture in my department. I am come to my department from the morning after, you know, finishing my job, the morning job. But it may be possible from my home, but not possible because there is a, you know, network is very bad. That's why I come here. But remember, this is a real problem. Now the technology, if we develop some technology in education, what should be the steps? Professor Ghosh will take the initiative to do some of the research. Why? How we can improve this online education system, digital education system, so that we can develop some technology and ultimately we can provide this wonderful education system to the every learner. And another important point is the promotion of Indian language. The new education policy also emphasizes in the areas of the new Indian languages. Yes, some of the listener question that the, you know, foreign language, how it is helping this. You know, if you visit to Vishwabharati, you can find that even in our university also, but one universities also. If you visit the US, you know, Vishwabharati, you can find a lot of foreign languages are there. Now the question is that why this is needed? This foreign language is needed. Some students can go to the, you know, Nepal. Some students go to the China. Some students go to the, you know, abroad and other you know, areas. They can use this degree and foreign language that is helpful for their, you know, life. Okay, so this is the time to check the, you know, checklist where we have, you know, trying to emphasize the point. And I think many things left. Actually, I have, you know, very beginning of my lecture, I told that this is very, very big, you know, 62 pages, but in real is more than 430 pages. But this policy, each and every point of the policy is very difficult to critically discuss, but we have to welcome to see that how much we can accommodate this, how much we can accommodate, and how it is possible. That strategy should be set up. Dr. Mukherjee sir mentioned that we have to take the strategy, we have to make the strategy so that we can welcome this. Well, criticism is there, critical discussion should be there. How we can achieve, that is the challenges. We have to achieve these challenges and to accommodate as much as possible. It's not mandatory that you have to follow total every each and every point, but you can accommodate as much as possible. Okay. So with this, thank you very much for giving me the opportunity. I must say that Dr. Nandi and Dr. Pal, Pankaj Pal, from the Gaurav Gwin Memorial College, and Dr. Nandi, they are my both of my direct student. So I must giving the special thanks to both of you to giving me the opportunity, and your principal sir allow me. That is why I am really thankful to all of faculty members and all. I must say that yesterday we are celebrating the Teachers Day, so I must pray my respectful pranam to all teachers, all teacher communities, all principals, sir, and give me ashirvad so that I will go forward. I can go forward. I can do something. Now over to Professor Nandi.
Nandita, please unmute yourself. Please unmute.
Hello, may I audible?
Hello. Yes.
Audible. Professor Nandi, you are audible.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Professor Mondal, sir. He has vividly explained National Education Policy 2020, and it is based on three basic terms: educate, encouragement, and enlightenment. He has nicely explained the universalization of education from pre-primary to secondary education with 100% gross enrollment assured, which will be assured in future context. He has explained ECCE, early childcare education, and the new format of 5+3+3+4 form in school education, PFMS, multilingualism and the power of language, and also change in assessment procedure. In higher education, he has referred Gurukul education systems, one single regulatory board, NHERC, research organizations, open and distance learning, digital education, scope of technology in education, and so many things related to higher education. Higher order thinking skills in critical thinking skill as well as conceptual clarity will be helped us to find the new path towards joyful learning, and we will reach our goal. I think so. Now, sir, we are moving to question answer session. Some participants, so many participants has been asked some questions. Here, the Pornob. So, may I take some questions, sir?
Yes. Please, Dr. Nandi, please go through the question.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Pornob Pattajisi, is there any provision for the foreign universities to admit to poor students in their institutions?
Yes, this is a very specific question, and actually we are not dealing with the foreign language or like that. But I must suggest, Professor Pranob sir, please you go through the abroad universities, different universities in the abroad, and to see that whether there is any possibilities to consider that the poor students in their institute or not. Actually, so far as our university is concerned, there is a policy, we have to consider this. But when a student goes to the foreign university for upliftment of his or her degrees, or do some higher education, I think maybe there's some provision to consider the student, but how much fellowship or how much help they are getting, that should be clearly mentioned in their website. So when anybody wish to go over there, they should go through this website to see that whether there is any provision or not, or what type of facilities they are giving. That is my suggestion, but I am not in a very concrete point that to give the answer.
next question. Pranav sir asking that, sir, please think of the rural areas. No technology will help them because of poor network.
Yeah. So this is very important. Nowadays, everybody, thinking about this. We are worried about that. Because in the rural area, our technology, telecommunication or the technology are not so improved. And that is why it is a problem. But remember, as the situation is like that, this is the invisible, coronavirus that giving many things visible. Such a small, invisible things giving the many things invisible. You are making this question nowadays because you are directly feeling some problem nowadays, isn't it? Because of the situation is like that. And that is why the new policy gives some focus, gives some light to this particular area that we have to do some, this is the challenges to develop this. Because nowadays, we are not in a position to say that our technology is really like that, so much improved. And rural area can get benefit from this technology. So we have to develop some technology.
Next question, sir. Jagobandhu Kalita asking whether government will give importance on qualitative development or quantitative development, mainly on higher education context.
Definitely. Thank you, Dr. Kalita. It is a really real picture because whatever we do, I must recall that you are just giving the question of your point there. One of the newspaper there is written. Can I show that newspaper cutting? I have a lot of newspaper cutting because whenever I read it, I like to collect it because I think that these are the novel thing. Anyway, see that whenever you go to the newspaper, you can find that there's some of the points that we may not implement the new policy because of the Gauri Senerava. Gauri Senerava. That means your question is like that. Whether the government will support? Yes, it is government will support. But question is that, UGC already called that your resource you have to generate. Until and unless you have to improve or you have to develop your resources, you may not be go forward. So, we get this something from the government and we have to formulate ourselves at how we can develop our resources, how you can improve this. So, I must support to your question that yes, there is a crisis, but we have to go forward. We have to try parallelly at how we can develop this situation. Okay, thank you.
Next question from Srishtidhar Bera. How will the policy be implemented without substantial investment, at least 6% GDP?
Okay. This is a very old debate. Dr. Vera, I am really happy to raise this question. Remember, everyone can raise this question. Well, that right now it is in pen and paper, 4.43% of GDP. But this is an NEP suggested that the GDP should be reached to the 6% so that we can achieve this. It's a real problem. So far as you can recall the Professor Srivastava lecture, where the Professor Srivastava mentioned that we are far behind from the other countries, where they are invest the more higher percentage on the education with respect to GDP. But we are really far away. But we have to try ourselves. Our government is giving this emphasis that the 6% GDP should be utilized in the field of education. And that is possible. If we are initially, you have to welcome this first. Then gradually, I believe that I believe that no work will be left. No work will be left. Only the crisis of the money. Money will be managed from anywhere. But your acceptance is very important, first of all. The government will definitely, government will help. The previous question, the government will definitely help. But at the same time, you can think that how you can generate resource from your institution. You can think that how it is possible that a primary school can develop a resource from its this institution. There is some ways. That is the challenges. We are not ready to accept this idea. You have to think it. There is a real, you know, last hopes are there. We can do, you know, something for the development of our country. Next.
So next, Hani Bigbal asking that only one language up to fifth standard is the biggest demerit, I think. What is the question?
See, as far as possible, policy tells that as far as possible, you can accommodate the language in this, pre-primary students and in the secondary level, if possible, up to the class 8, but it is up to the class 5. However, it is a real problem. That is, I hope that you gone through some of the newspaper news that the West Bengal, Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, these are the test, these are the state, they are directly conflict. They are directly, raise their, opposition. They told that it is not possible that language, that one language consideration in this level up to the age of 5 or up to the class 5, how it is possible to, but that is a real problem. But we have to take the challenge.
Okay, sir, thank you once again. And no more questions are there in the screen.
Okay. So,
hello.
Yes, no more questions are there.
But I must welcome some question, Professor Doctor, from Dr. Ghosh. Because Dr. Ghosh in computer science, I am really, you see, that Dr. Ghosh, you have enough chance to do something according to this new policy.
In the policy, what about the making of software to the school children? Sir, can you highlight on that? Sir, it is said that the coding will be started from 6th standard, but to making any software school children can make. So is there any provision for that?
Why you are thinking in this way? You can think.
Yes. Very much useful, and this makes the children very much intelligent rather than doing mathematics, I think. Okay. So in that respect, it's my suggestion to include to making software, making code. These type of stuffs are very much required for nowadays.
Yeah,
for the children, from the school level. I'm not talking about the college level.
Okay. Dr. Ghosh, I have an idea immediately. It just came in my mind. See,
yes.
Each and every family, they are using a, telephone. Nowadays, it is a mobile phone. Okay. Can you make some of the software and to suggest the government that the telephone, many of us, we are using ringtone. Okay. You can use this, you can develop some software instead of the specific ringtone to your educational aspect, that you are giving some of the, some of the point when this mobile phone is ringing, that should be some, some of the, giving some of the idea to the learner that they are listening, not the music. Giving some of the, you are trying to develop some, to make the proficiency in English language. Okay. So, 1 minute or 30 second, 30-second ringtone, you can provide some of the language development software.
Okay, sir. Language development means you are talking about the translation of languages, right?
Translation of language. Yes.
Sir, it is very much possible. It is already there. It is already there in the Google itself. You can see in the Google Doc. There is a lot of provision are there. You can directly by audio. You can write without typing from the keyboard. By audio only, you can type any languages in the from the a language set. You can took any language, maybe Bangla, maybe Hindi, maybe Arabic, maybe English, any language, and then you can translate it in any language. Okay, so the provision is already there in the Google itself, so it is already built, so you can
Dr. Ghosh, actually whenever you go to the Google and is it possible to make it more user friendly in the mobile phone, that the learner can get something from the by their mobile phone without using special software like that? But your suggestion is that you can suggest the comment that we have to develop some of the software, and that should be replace the every ringtone to like this, and that should be when the mobile phone is in the home or any in their home, that ringtone can be converted to this educational perspective, like that some language proficiency or like that. I don't know whether this is possible or not, but if it is possible, you can think like this.
Yes sir, you're talking about the research field. This is a very much research field, that the voice can be transferred to language. The research is going on this field, so it can be possible to make any software if the public work can be used.
But the major problem is that we are network, because we are thinking about the poor student and rural student. They have no infrastructure.
Should think about this matter regarding the online teaching and online all the work from home concept. So network should be very much strong, and it is to be free for the children, for the school level. I think. Then the popularity of online classes will grow. Otherwise, majority of the students is deferred from this system.
Definitely. Okay. Thank you, Dr. Ghosh.
Thank you,
sir,
for your enlightened lecture. Now it's time to conclude the session. So I will request Dr. Pankaj Kumar Pal to for vote of thanks.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Midul. I want to convey my expressive vote of thanks, that this is my privilege to have been asked to propose a vote of thanks on the occasion of webinar New Education Policy, Challenges and Opportunities. So in this regard, I want to convey my sincere thanks, Honorable Professor Ashish Srivastava sir, and Honorable Speaker Professor Navakumar Mondal sir, my teacher also, and three important patron of three colleges, Shampur Siddheshwari Mahavidyalay, Dr. S.K. Bose, Ramsadai College, Dr. Dev Kumar Mukhopadhyay, Dr. Tapun Hazra, TIC of my college, and conveners, secretaries, IQC coordinators of three colleges, technical staffs and other members of webinar committee, and also the participants. So I, on behalf of the organizing secretary of the webinar committee, extend my hearty vote of thanks to the honorable delegates who blessed us with their presence and took their valuable time for their busy schedule. In spite of their busy schedule, I must mention our deep sense of appreciation for Professor Srivastava sir and Professor Mondal sir for their valuable speech regarding New Education Policy 2020. I like to speak to notable speakers because they have expressed their views, delivered their speech regarding different aspects of New Education Policy, different lacunas and possible outcomes also. I wish to express my gratitude to the principals and TICs of three colleges for providing their encouragement, because without this, this webinar cannot make a grand success. I am also grateful to our conveners, organizing secretary, technical staff, IQC coordinators, and other members of organizing committee for giving an opportunity to organize this kind of event, that is program. I heartily congratulate to the participants for their active participation and presence in this event. As no program can become successful with a single person or effort, so I extend my big thanks to Department of Education as well as Computer Science of Shampur Siddheshwari Mahavidyalay and Department of Education Ramsadai College and Department of Education also Gaurav Queen Memorial College, that is my department, for their support, and also our volunteers too. Once again, I would like to give my heartfelt thanks to our invited two speakers, that is Professor Ashish Srivastava sir and Professor Navakumar Mondal sir, for making this event successful, and ultimately for the patience of the participants for hearing the program, presenting the program almost 20-30 minutes. Lastly, I just want to say a few words that we have heard several aspects of new education policy, that is National Education Policy 2020, and possible outcomes, lacunas, merits, demerits also, and many things. But I think we have to wait a few years, that is almost a decade, 10 years, in order to judge its possible outcomes and how it will be implemented, or possible implementation, or is there any problems for implementation in future or not. Thank you. Just I am concluding my vote of thanks. Thank you, because participants are hearing a long outing webinar. Thank you.